So good afternoon. I'm Quentin Lucas, the mayor of Kansas City. Only removing my mask so I can share the message. I know there's some lip readers out there as well. We are here today to announce a few more requirements with Kansas City's response to COVID-19, particularly Safer at Home KC. I know that there have been many who have talked to us about things ranging from wanting a total lockdown or a total shutdown of activities to wanting no requirements at all. We consider this to be a partial change, partial shutdown in certain social activities that are occurring in Kansas City primarily. And a few things to announce for us today. First of all, why are we here? We're here because we have reached a point, I think our greatest crisis moment in Kansas City's response to COVID-19. As we all recognize, it is a regional issue. In the last week, you would have heard recommendations from chief medical officers at hospitals around the region that talked about the decline in available ICU beds and other hospital resources. That is based on demand that is coming not just from Kansas City, not just from our suburbs, but also from rural Missouri and Kansas. And just the last week, I've had a number of conversations with folks who talked about the fact that we're seeing patients at places like Research Medical Center in Kansas City, Truman Medical Center, St. Luke's, etc., that are dealing with an influx of patients from throughout the region. And we thought it was important and time to act. As you also would have seen and reported last week, health directors, not just Dr. Rex Archer of Kansas City, but the health directors of Jackson and Jackson County, Missouri, Clay County, Platte County, Wyandotte County, Johnson County, Kansas, listed a set of recommendations for us, and it's those recommendations that are a basis for the orders that we're announcing today. First, change in restaurant and bar rules. You will see that restaurants and bars, we have a recommendation of closure at 10 p.m. In Kansas City, Missouri, bars are allowed in some situations to be open until 3 a.m. So why cutting 5 hours of possible business for them? First, we recognize the challenge, but we also recognize the fact that particularly in the later hours through our health department enforcement, we've seen laxer enforcement from private actors of rules relating to social distancing, laxer enforcement of mask requirements, and those challenges have led us to believe that this is the best way before people are inebriated in later hours, before they're crowding, to avoid certain bar and restaurant issues. Another addition is the fact that at all bars and restaurants in Kansas City, you must be seated while in the facility. So no standing around. My office often receives videos or pictures from certain entertainment districts throughout Kansas City where folks are standing around on dance floors, close to each other, etc. The seating requirement will be something that is enforced for all restaurants and bars unless you're actively going to be seated or going to a restroom or something of that sort, and you must be seated. If you are standing at any time, you must have a mask on. Violations of those rules will be enforced by our health department as well as the Department of Regulated Industries. This order also gives the police department, the fire department's ability to enforce relevant parts of those orders. There has been some question as to the requirement to wear masks for all those in Kansas City. This order eliminates the exception of wearing masks for everyone, largely. That means that those who are members of the Kansas City Police Department, the Kansas City Fire Department, and others are required to wear masks in commission of their duties as well. This will be an all-around requirement for everyone, very few exceptions. The exceptions continued, it will now be only children under the age of 5 are exempted, or those who can't wear masks for certain medical reasons. No longer is there an exemption for public safety, essential business, any other types of items. A few other things to note. Restaurant and bar capacity will be limited to 50% in Kansas City. In addition, gyms, fitness centers, and other recreational centers, including, and importantly, school-based gyms and recreation centers, will have a mask requirement and will be subject to social distancing and capacity requirements as well. There is much question about indoor and winter sports activities. As this order is currently written in relation to both schools and youth activities, those would require a mask to be worn if they're taking part. If there is an effort to have some crowd at a venue, that would have to be approved by the Director of Public Health because there is an additional rule that limits all groups to the number 10. So group limits being at a size of 10. All groups. And so if you look to have an indoor event, congregation, etc., you may not if it's over 10, unless there is some specific permission from the Director of Public Health. That will include spectators at games, concerts, events, weddings, etc. I've had a few people ask me questions. Mayor Lucas, my daughter or son is getting married at a Kansas City entertainment venue in 2 weeks. Can that proceed? The answer, rather clearly, is no, unless there is some explicit approval from the Department of Public Health. A few other things to note, and then I'll introduce our other speakers for today. One of those is that we take these actions not to be punitive, and we certainly take them cognizant of business challenges in Kansas City. I had a conversation with our director of the Economic Development Corporation of Kansas City, who noted that Kansas City, Missouri has given out more than $3.2 million in small business funding support in recent months. We call on our allies, both at the federal legislative level and the state legislative level, to help us help our businesses. But importantly, it is vital for us to continue to try to stop the spread of COVID-19. A few other points that I wanted to mention while we were still here. We do believe that reducing the size of all groups to 10 will be something that makes a strong difference, but there is more to that. You really should not be associating with many groups outside of your home yourself. That's why we're seeing a limit on public activities. That's why we're seeing some of the issues that we are addressing now. What's more, we will add a mask requirement in the outdoors if you cannot maintain social distancing or if there's no health or other public safety issue relating to that distance issue as well. I continue to call on the counties that surround us in the Kansas City area to issue things like mask requirements. I continue to ask so many others to look at the good public health guidance that we need. Kansas City is working its hardest to make sure that people stay safe. Each day, we're working with our school districts, we're working with our hospital leadership, we're working with so many to make sure that folks can be safe long term. But importantly, it relies on everyone. It relies on folks to follow the rules. It relies on us to enforce the rules. We will continue to enforce the rules, whether it be a U-Haul facility, a club, a bar, or anything of that sort. If you have an issue with compliance with COVID-19 rules, we encourage you, if you've seen non-compliance, to email COVID violations@kcmo.org, or to call 311. Dr. Archer's department has had quite a bit of work to do over recent months, but we have appreciated many who have contacted us. That's why we're giving a direct line for those sorts of violations at issue. I also have noted this already, but we recommend folks cancel at least the normal version of their Thanksgiving plans. We also recommend that all other large event plans be canceled or postponed if you can do so. It's very simple. Every wedding, every Thanksgiving, every large event is a potential for large community spread. We have seen it time and again. People that did not intend to get relatives sick, people who did not intend to get friends sick, people who did not intend to get coworkers sick. That has been a significant problem for us. And so we ask you, we implore you, that through the full extent of our legal orders as possible, we direct you to make sure that you are not engaging in any activities above 10 persons, and to make sure that you're not engaging in those activities that will be risky for Kansas City or our entire region. I'll be followed today by Dr. Rex Archer, our Director of Public Health, then Dr. Erica Carney, our Director of Emergency Medical Services, and then Adele Duchard. She'll give you her full name and spelling, from St. Luke's North Hospital to talk about the impact. I'll come back and answer questions, followed by Dr. Archer answering questions, and then we'll see if we still have an appetite to proceed from there. A few other things that I'll note just before I get off. This has been a regional conversation and a regional effort. You're seeing orders perhaps rolled out in different times. Some of that relates to political realities of different jurisdictions. I've had the opportunity to talk to leaders in a number of different areas, most recently Jackson County, Wyandotte County, and Johnson County just last night. I know Dr. Archer has talked to health directors throughout our region and all health directors throughout our region. Everybody recognizes there's a significant challenge and there's a significant concern, even if our rules may look a little different. We encourage all of you to wear masks, maintain social distancing, and refrain from social events. We can't say that enough. And if we do this over the next several months, that may buy us the time necessary to get to the point where we have a vaccine, to get to the point where we can be safer. So with that, I'll introduce Dr. Rex Archer for us.
So COVID is spiraling out of control in Kansas City right now. We had 575 new cases between Thursday and Friday in that 24-hour period. The challenge that we have is emergency room beds are not set up to manage ICU patients or inpatient stay, therefore stabilizing for an emergency. When we have multiple hospitals around the area that are holding patients in emergency rooms that should be up in other beds, that can really lead to problems. And we can have a substantial increase in deaths because we're not able to get people to the care that they need. If we think about these orders, they are enough to make a pretty darn big difference with the personal responsibility of everybody following them. And that's the key. We know that when we change laws, non-smoking in public places, etc., that yes, we enforce, but a lot of it is peer support and each other looking out for each other and reminding folks. So we really need everybody to get on board, because otherwise we can end up with much worse restrictions to save the lives that we could avoid if everybody follows this. As the mayor mentioned, you can report at those two sites in regards to if you're seeing violations so that we can follow up. We've actually followed up on about 3,500 complaints so far, and we expect that to continue. And last but not least, we are developing a form to expedite the process by which when people want to have a gathering above 10, that they can fill out the form and submit it. You will need to fill it out a week in advance, or it may very well not get approved because there won't be time to review that. So with that, I'll have Dr. Carty come up and speak.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Dr. Archer. As the Region A Medical Director, we have had time to talk to all of the hospitals within our region and all of the EMS agencies. It is no lie that our hospitals are at an unprecedented capacity right now. Our hospitals are full. This is a combination of different variables. We've got increased volume just in general from the beginning of the pandemic. We've got increased COVID admissions. These patients take up hospital beds for much longer than other illnesses. And we've got decreasing staff. Our staff is out on quarantine and isolation. So the combination of all three of these things has led to an unprecedented capacity issue for our region. As healthcare workers, we are no longer the front line. In the community, you guys now are the front line. We ask you guys for your help. Wear your masks, cancel your plans, and help us maintain some type of capacity within the region. Thank you so much, Mayor and Dr. Archer.
Hello, my name is Adele Ducharme, Ducharme, and I am the president and CEO at St. Luke's North Hospital. St. Luke's Health System, like all hospitals in our community, are caring for some of the sickest patients battling COVID-19. Healthcare workers are doing everything we can on a daily basis to help our community, and we plead with all of you to rally together and follow the guidelines to help us curb the virus. The fight against COVID is one that involves all of us, and we are proud to partner with the city and local leaders to do what we can to help get the spread, to help fight the spread, and reduce the number of cases in Kansas City. Thank you.
Like before, we'll do questions in an order this direction over. I will note one other thing that I wanted to mention. We are cognizant of the fact that there have been many restaurants, bars in particular, that might have had COVID outbreaks. As part of this order, there is a mandate that if anyone at your business establishment comes down with COVID-19, you must immediately notify the Department of Public Health about that case. In the event you don't, you will be subject to certain penalties in Kansas City too, up to and including closure of the business. We also have heard a lot about different events that are happening in Kansas City at private venues, etc. In this order, there is no distinction between public or private types of venues. If you have a country club event, if you have a members-only event, those are also prohibited under this order, absent some further permissions. And so there is consistency broadly for everyone involved in this order, because whether you are going to a very nice wedding or going to a concert, anything under the sun, it's our view that all of those are situations where we can see the spread of COVID-19, and all of those are prohibited under this order. Questions? I'll start here. Yes?
Are there any plans to set up field hospitals?
In terms of setting up field hospitals, I would defer to the health director, but typically those are done in alignment with the state of Missouri and others. There have already been plans made before. The governor identified the Independence Event Center as one of the locations. I don't think those plans have changed, and so we would still have that opportunity at some point later. But for now, we're trying to make sure that through the mitigation strategies that we're working on, we can actually address those issues long term. Yes, any questions for you? Yes.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, I interviewed you back in April, I think it was, and the question that I had that came up was about law enforcement, about giving law enforcement the tools to enforce the mandates that the city does. I know the health department can't do it alone. Were they there now?
Yeah. In terms of law enforcement and others enforcing mandates, I had a bit of a disagreement with some of our public safety leadership back in March or April, because I believe they gave a press conference that noted how they were not enforcing certain mandates. I didn't think that was the right approach then, and now it absolutely is the wrong approach. My expectation is this: if the taxpayers of Kansas City pay your salary or pay a departmental salary, then it's your job to actually enforce the rules, the lawful rules of Kansas City. This order is backed by the U.S. Constitution, the Missouri Constitution, the Charter of Kansas City. These are laws. These are rules. People need to follow them. If they don't follow them, then they can be shut down by any number of forces. And it is not just the Kansas City Health Department. It's the Kansas City Police Department. It's the Fire Marshal if there's a capacity issue. It's the Department of Regulated Industries if there's anyone with a liquor license who's violating our rules. All of those departments will be engaged in terms of this enforcement effort. We will continue to be fair in how we enforce, but what we will not allow is for a party of 200 people to go unrestricted because Dr. Archer's staff is busy or has gone home at 2 a.m. on a Saturday. That is the sort of activity the police department should be a part of. I'll expect them to be a part of that, and I think we'll make clear to Kansas Cityans, much like in every other city, that every agency that's a part of that effort should be a part of it long term.
Yeah,
sure. Yes, sir.
So the sidewalk cafe eating, that's no longer in effect. Second question is, everybody in the restaurant has to have or a club has to have a mask unless they're sitting down, so no more dancing in the club.
So on both questions, one, sidewalk cafes can continue to exist for as long as people can handle being outside. And so sidewalk cafes, sidewalk restaurants, sidewalk bars continue to exist. Importantly, you need to sit down while you're there. We've seen a lot of concerns, and if you look again at entertainment districts, there have been some parties, and I happen to live close to a street that in and of itself is an entertainment district, it seems sometimes, where we've seen about 1,000 people that are consuming beverages and all of that. That would be something that could be shut down. Everybody needs to be seated. In terms of dance clubs and activities like that, assuming that there is not a possibility for people to maintain social distancing, then that activity would not be able to continue until the end of this order.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead, yes?
The
order begins 12:01 a.m. on Friday, so really Thursday night if you think about it, but it'll be effective this Friday morning at 12:01 a.m. Yes, ma'am.
I've got a few.
Yes, ma'am.
When the White House suggested limiting restaurant capacity earlier this fall, you had talked about how you're somewhat limited by what other jurisdictions are doing. This is stricter than what Johnson County did late last week.
Yes.
Can you talk about why you made that decision?
Yeah, so on that first question, I would love for everybody to work together and to be with one another in connection with our orders. I was heartened that Johnson County did something. I was disheartened that they didn't go, I think, as far as will be helpful for us. I know the Johnson County order also allows bars and restaurants to be open till midnight. As anyone may know, if you've been to a bar or an establishment, the activity that may exist at midnight may be somewhat different than what you're seeing at 9 o'clock, 9:30. 9 o'clock, 9:30 still may be a more restaurant crowd. Importantly, it may be a crowd that is not as young as the later hours are. 50% of our new transmissions in Kansas City have been folks who are in their 20s and 30s, and so we thought it was very important for us to actually address the issues where we're seeing the most significant spread. And it is a bar, nightclub, lounge type of activity, and we've seen most of the threats, particularly in the later hours of the night. In terms of another difference that we have in this order from Johnson County, of course, is the 10 versus 50 rule. In Johnson County, gatherings are to be limited to 50 persons or 50% of a venue. 50% of a venue is such a wide exception that I think you can, you know, just kind of drive a Mack truck through it. But in terms of 10 people, our view is very simply the idea that let's try to make real concrete steps with our orders here. And the real concrete step we're trying to say is people shouldn't be convening in the same way. For better or worse, despite the orders we've had for recent months relating to masks, we've continued to see a lot of the same events happen again. In Kansas City, Missouri, for example, folks were able to sneak in and have a wrestling tournament at the former Kemper Arena. That was problematic, but it did not actually violate our technical orders. Here we, I think, have clarified those loopholes, and the reason that we're taking this action now is because at a certain point you have to lead as well. It's our view that Kansas City will be in a leadership position with having orders that at least at this point will be the most restrictive, not because we want to be the toughest, but because this is what we have heard, by and large, is important for us to address the long-term concerns. I will continue to talk to leadership in Johnson County and would love for us to be as consistent as we can, not to mention the fact that we also have Northland counties, Clay and Platt, where the non-KCMO portions are subject to what would be none of our rules, and so bars could be open to whatever the limits are, etc. We'll work with them to try to build some consistency with that as time goes on.
Have you had an issue with businesses not being forthcoming with COVID outbreaks?
Yes, we have had an issue with businesses not being forthcoming with COVID outbreaks. I think it's incredibly disappointing. I think it's heartless, and I don't think it's the sort of thing that any business should be allowed to do. I get more messages than anyone would think from folks that work at a restaurant and say, we had an outbreak, but they didn't report it to your health department. That is in many ways unconscionable. I have had more messages from photographers at wedding venues who are saying there were 300 people in a venue, they're not wearing masks, everybody's dancing, everybody's close, and that is an issue. That cannot go forward. And this is why you have rules and why you have laws. While I agree that we can try to lean on people's best senses of kindness to their fellow man, that's not working. And so I think we need to make sure that we're actually addressing it through our laws and orders right now. Yes?
Why were police previously exempted from the mask order, and why did that change?
So the previous exemption was based on the fact that all of our orders started actually with a shutdown of all activities. So government employees, essential workers, police, fire, everyone was a lot of people rather, were exempted from our orders because during the stay-at-home initial order, the idea was police, firefighters will continue to come to work, that sort of thing. As we modified our orders over time, actually, which is somewhat concerning, up until this order will be in effect, essential workers of any type are exempt from the mask requirement, including, for example, journalists. I don't think we necessarily meant for that to be the case, but because we, in essence, were allowing folks to continue to work back in April, at least come to work and do all types of issues and things, we found it important to have them exempted from all of our rules. I think we've changed it now for the better. Yes?
And are you considering a restriction on outdoor gatherings at all?
Yeah, so yes is the answer. Currently the issue is that outdoors we will have the social distancing requirements. That's why we have with drinking and eating where people tend to be brought together, rules on the outdoors as well. There is an enforcement challenge with outdoors. If 50 spontaneous people come to the steps of City Hall and let's say want to have an encampment, for example, there are some questions as to enforceability, how you can best do that. And so I think right now we're trying to impact in the areas where we can best have some impact. We don't see a lot of larger events in Kansas City. I will note there was a a function, I believe, in the plaza area where someone came in and had a big conference. That would be in violation of this order because everyone was there not socially distanced without a plan for how to have space between themselves. And so we think that we can capture most of our threatening activities through the rules as laid out.
Mayor,
yes, sir.
You just conceded that previous plans weren't working. What if this doesn't work? Then we're
Well, there are two options. If this doesn't work, then we can hope that we have a vaccine developed fast enough to have some colorable change on our response to COVID-19. But if the plan doesn't work, then we will need to come back and look to more extensive orders. I don't think that I'm saying anything that folks don't understand. There was conversation about the need perhaps to have more significant orders. In a lot of Midwestern states, Michigan being the most recent example, you're seeing more significant shutdowns of most activities. While we recommend that every employer in Kansas City allow their employees to work from home if it is possible, we are not mandating that with this order. However, if we continue to see an increase not just in demand on beds, but also in fatalities and those falling sick, then we will evaluate, particularly after the Thanksgiving holiday, further steps that may need to be taken.
Just to be clear, you are telling Kansas City, in effect, to cancel Thanksgiving gatherings. They might not have one with your family, but...
Yes. In an unmitigated way, we are asking Kansas Cityans to not take part in Thanksgiving gatherings, the types of which they might have in years past.
And how concerned are you that people will ignore that or simply going to ruin the tradition of that holiday?
I continue to be concerned about any number of things, but I think we have to make clear through some practice. I noted on social media yesterday, like many, I have a family of some size. I will not see them on Thanksgiving. There are different ways to contact people, but I mean, here's the deal. It's about people actually staying safe. I'll give you one vignette and a story because it encapsulates so many of our concerns. I was talking to a friend of mine on the phone whose relative fell sick from the Kansas side, originally treated at a Johnson County hospital, were transferred to Research Medical Center in Kansas City. The sickness came up at a family event. There are more family events where we have seen the tragic spread of COVID-19 than folks want to let on. That's why we're asking for it. No one wants to be the Grinch, neither I, Dr. Archer, Dr. Carney, or anyone. But we are asking folks to take these important steps so that we can get to a more positive situation later on. Increasing case numbers, increasing sickness, and the fact that our deaths have increased tremendously over recent months is a public health crisis for this region. And I'll just give you one example. As you know, Mike, there may be a lot of people that are mad at me all the time, and throughout the summer, many were saying, Lucas, you have more homicides in your city than you do deaths from COVID-19. Why are we doing all of this for COVID-19 but not shutting down the city for any other type of issue? The amazing thing that's happened since, however, or the disappointing thing that's happened since, is that we have now vastly surpassed the number of deaths that we had from violent crime with COVID-19, and we continue to increase roughly 10 a week or more. This will continue to be a significant problem, and I'm not comfortable just sitting back and saying, call me when 1,000 people in Kansas City, Missouri have died, or when 5,000 people in the metro area have died. That's why we're taking these important steps now. I think they're responsible. I think they're balanced. We talk to businesses, we talk to schools, we talk to everyone who's impacted by these regulations, but that's why we're doing them. Sorry to be long-winded. Anything else?
Yeah.
Ma'am, anything for you? Okay.
Hi, Mayor. Two questions for you. How do these orders affect Chiefs home games and schools?
Chiefs home games, because they will have, they've gone through an approval process with the health department. I would assume would exist under the same orders. The health director continues to have consistent conversations with the president of the Chiefs and everyone in leadership there. We will continue to do that. But yes, the order of 10 will apply as a bar unless you've gone through explicit lengthy approvals with the health department to make sure that things will be acceptable. In terms of schools, it should not impact the regular school day and school environment. The order is explicit in that. However, for example, school athletic events after school, high school basketball games would be the sort of thing that would be limited to 10 folks in the stands, absent some other order from the Department of Public Health.
This may be a question for Dr. Archer, but can you speak about the positivity rate we have currently and why that's a big player in this?
If you're my last question, then I'll just switch over to Dr. Archer and say, yes.
Mayor. The first one is, are you guys prepared for maybe the exorbitant amount of calls that you'll get to approve events, especially with the holidays coming up?
Short answer is yes. We know there will be a significant volume. We'll do our best to get through them. Our job is to make sure people are safe. We don't get to just say administration is a challenge to have coming up with rules that can make Kansas City safer long term. One thing I would encourage, however, for people, and I like to go to a look, I'm the mayor, right? What did mayors do before COVID-19? We went to an event every night, we shook hands, we did all that sort of stuff. I, as much as anybody who used to do probably 8 events a day, I was used to that. This is a time where we should probably, over the next month, the real answer, rather than calling the director of public health and saying, can you have your office Christmas party, is to actually probably say, this is not the year that we should probably have that holiday party. And that's what we're trying to get across to this region right now.
Yes. Second question, of course, as you said earlier, this affects a lot of holiday celebrations with people over 10 in indoor meetings. Are you guys primarily relying on self-reporting of these kind of events, or will there be some sort of checking process at random?
You know, we do a mix of both. So I'll use the alcohol model and alcohol regulation. We have a regulated industries department that makes sure that folks aren't selling to minors. They spot check. They observe things. They listen to complaints. They go through that varied process. We will do the same thing in this situation. Some of it might be calls. Some of it might be inspection. That is consistent with local government. That's why it's important to have the police department, the fire department, and others that are out naturally more be a part of our enforcement efforts. But those will be the steps that are taken long term with this. Any other questions for me? Are we good with Dr. Archer? Yes, sir.
I just got this in the text. He says, we practice at home field in South Kansas City. There are at least 10 teams in there at a time. Just wondering how this is going to play out. Will they have to cut the number of teams they allow inside?
The short answer would be yes, unless there's some further approval from the Department of Public Health, at least during the pendency of the order. All right? With that, I'll have Dr. Archer, and he'll be our last speaker for today.
So I want to clarify a couple of things in a little more detail. Field hospitals will only work if you can then staff them. And the problem right now isn't that we don't have enough beds, ICU and regular beds in the metro area. We do. The problem is that the level of community spread is impacting the hospital employees so that they can't staff the beds. So we can't magically wave a wand and think we're going to set up a field hospital, because where are those workers going to come from? At the level that this outbreak is occurring across the country, there's not going to be healthcare workers like there were early with New York City to be able to send to us, because everybody else is very crowded. I want to talk about a couple of other specific details. One, you don't have to wait till this goes into order on Friday. A voluntary compliance is always accepted, and in fact, most parents have been having their kids wear masks even though there was an exception. So we expect that people could start moving along this line. We set that date for Friday to make sure that those that had more serious issues in regards to rescheduling and that would have some time to kind of work through those dynamics. On the Chiefs, in fact, let me back up. If the mayor requested to have a press conference inside, I wouldn't permit it now. At least not in a crowded venue. We'd have to find a space where everybody could socially distance enough to do that. Because we're outdoors and there's enough wind and you're spread out and everybody's wearing masks, we're permitting this right now. But those are the kinds of things that we have to work through and decide. With the Chiefs, it's a good example. If it was an indoor stadium, I might be in a very different situation. If we had groups and the Chiefs were wanting to have groups of greater than 10 seated together in various places, then I would have a problem with that. They do have, on the club level, the suites. So as part of their plan, which not everybody can do, but they're able to pre-test 72 hours before anybody goes into that suite. So even though it's more than 10 folks that would be in that suite, they have a mechanism. We had over 1,000 tests at the last home game. There were 25 positive. those folks were not allowed to go into the suites, and we've not had any outbreaks to date at the Chiefs games. That doesn't mean we won't with the size and the volume, but it should be contained within that pod or group that we're isolating. So that's an important distinction for people to understand. Another important part here is on Thanksgiving. Boy, I love Thanksgiving, and it's a great time to get together. But one of the fastest growing medical conditions right now is a guilt grief reaction to having spread this virus to somebody else that you care about that then ends up hospitalized or worse. So don't ruin Thanksgiving for 2021 by having an event now that could cause harm to people that you love and you want to get together with. You know, I think by next year we'll be in a different situation and we should be able to have Thanksgivings, but this year I don't think it's a wise thing to do. And let's see, just because we are saying that you can have indoor dining and bars where masks may come off if you're seated, doesn't mean that I advise that for anybody over 50 or anybody that has various pre-existing medical conditions. We're not prohibiting it, but I don't, as the medical doctor for our community and with support of others, believe that that is in any way safe. We know this virus isn't just spread by droplets. It's not just a 6-foot issue. That's part of why at the Chiefs game we actually had that 9 feet in front, because people are shouting, and if they have their masks off for a while, the virus can move further forward. The other challenge we have, and this is why we have influenza outbreaks more often in the winter, is viral particles, RNA viruses, tend to suspend in the air. And if there's not enough humidity in the air, the virus doesn't drop out very fast, so it could be recirculated. So that's our concern also by the density of keeping the density down in rooms, is that you can still get the virus. These are not N95s that we're wearing. These help keep you from giving the virus to somebody else. They reduce the odds of you getting it a lot, but it's not the same as what we provide for hospital workers with N95s and eye shields, face shields. When we send our workers out to inspect homes, they have to wear a mask plus a face shield to adequately protect themselves. So with that, I think there was a question.
What if you have a large house and you have an upstairs and a downstairs, you got 10 people in there, 11 people, what's that for Thanksgiving?
So this is exactly the kind of questions and things that we want people to kind of be thinking through. If you can socially distance, but the challenge is then, how are you gonna, I've seen these events, and even if you have it where people go through and pick up their food, are you staying socially distanced? Are people wearing masks or not? Those are the kinds of things to think about. There's no fine line where exactly at this point it becomes dangerous and at this point it wasn't. There's a gradient. So we have problems where we have outbreaks where somebody has COVID in a family unit, and sometimes, particularly if they have separate bedroom and bathroom, they can keep isolated and the other members of the family don't get it even though it's in the house. So washing your hands, keeping your distance, being prudent, but we are asking for folks to limit to 10 pretty much regardless of size of the establishment right now, because it's pretty hard to, you can't clean the utensils. If you're going through and serving lines, everybody's touching that or probably touching it. It gets pretty complicated.
Dr. Archer, you got at least one zip code in Kansas City, Missouri, where the rate is 3 times what it is for the rest of the city. There's another one close to it. There's a couple of districts where it's double what it is in the city. Are there any efforts underway to address specifically those spots where it is 40, 50, 60%
positivity rate?
So we have to understand positivity rate a little bit. Positivity rate means what percentage of the folks that were tested are positive. So it depends on who you're testing in that community. We don't have any zip codes that have a 10, 15, 20% of the entire people in that zip code that have had or have the virus right now. We will get there.
Doctor,
if we don't.
Your own stats, you got the 64124 at 64.29%.
That's percent positivity.
Correct.
Not everybody's been tested.
My point remains, that's a big, bad number. Are you targeting these districts that have those other exceptionally big numbers?
We are working to try to do more testing in those areas. Some of those areas, the reason that they got that bad to begin with was that's where some of the initial outbreaks occurred with the St. Joe meatpacking plant, the Aspen plant. But yes, Mike, we are addressing those issues, but I need the media to help the public understand that 64% positivity doesn't mean that 64% of the people living in that zip code have the virus. And even if 64% of the people have had the virus, it doesn't mean 64% of them are infectious now that can pass the virus. So we've got to make some distinctions and understand. In some cases, we had a positivity rate, I remember when we were reporting a daily a few months ago, where we had a positivity rate of 70%. Well, that was tests on Sunday that were done in the emergency room of symptomatic people. So you have to understand what that positivity rate means.
So briefly, 64% of the testing.
Of the folks that were tested during that time period. And that could be they were positive in March and are no longer infectious. Then it's still included in that 64%.
Doctor, I have one question.
Yes.
Does this apply to churches and places of worship?
So, congregations, places of worship, any type of gathering needs to take this seriously because they don't want to harm their own members. We have a lot of congregations that are submitting plans to us, and we will review those plans and work with them to try to figure out how to do it safely. Obviously, singing is a real challenge because if you're singing without a mask on, the virus can go 12, 15 feet. So there are a lot of changes. You'll see a number of congregations that have made changes where they have a plexiglass around the pulpit or lectern so that the preacher isn't spewing the virus out into the rest of the crowd. They're seating by those groups that are coming together in that car to come to the service, and they're keeping separation. So we've had outbreaks in religious communities, but So we want to work with any religious community on how to do this safely.
Will a church have to apply for a weekly exemption?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Once we've worked out their facility and what's safe for them, now if they think that there's going to be some changes that are occurring or they want to do something new, then we'll try to work with them to help them do it as safely as possible. But no, they won't be applying every week. That would, I don't have time for that. But thank you for clarifying it, because I don't want a church to think they have to.
For clarification, there was listed in the order that they are under that exemption, like education. So they don't have to submit a plan every week.
They don't have to submit a plan, but I don't know one that doesn't want to do it as safely as possible. And that's where I think we can work with them, and we have been working with a lot of churches to do it safer.
Last question is very quick. Dr. Steven Seitz, KU Health System, said that the numbers we're seeing now are obviously pre-holiday celebrations. He's gravely worried that they're going to be much worse after. Do you share that?
We've had increases after almost every holiday from back at, you know, Memorial Day and Mother's Day and Father's Day, etc. So, yes, and what we're hearing is there are a number of universities that are deciding to go virtual only after Thanksgiving, so they're sending all their students back home from other areas that may even have higher rates than we have. So that's why this is so important, and why personal responsibility of doing everything you can to slow down this virus so that we can keep this under control. Otherwise, yes, we may have to do more to be able to keep our hospitals from being overrun. Thank you.
Thank you.